Okay, thank you for the patience. Thank you for coming to my talk. This talk is on a computer music environment I've been working on for the past perhaps 10 years, if you count all the components together. I'm from Graz, from Austria, where I work, among other things, at the Institute of Electronic Music and Acoustic. That's a research and teaching department in the Music Academy. And currently, I'm running a research project on algorithmic agency with respect to sound and sound experimentation called Algorithms That Matter, in which Mellite is one of the different tools or approaches we employ. My first kind of serious software, let's say, I have written maybe in 2001. It was a Java application called Fscape. It's still very much in use today. It's also a music application that takes the idea of rendering sound. So what does it mean? It's a non-real-time process. That means it takes a sound file, applies a particular transformation, let's say, manipulate the spectrum, manipulate the time, and output another sound file, and then you can use that to do other things. Later on, I learned in a real-time system, many real-time systems, one of them is SuperCollider. It's also quite common language in the area of computer music. And I tried, in a way, for a while to combine that with a specific language based a little bit. It's a specific language. It's not a general purpose language, but it's kind of based on Ruby and Smalltalk and other ideas. And I tried for a while to bridge that with my Java projects. And then finally, in 2008, I actually discovered Scala. Here's a mailing list post I unearthed about my first contact with Scala. Hello, I'm new to Scala. I'm currently evaluating for a large-scale project which language could replace the default language of the SuperCollider sound synthesis environment. And then it goes on elaborating a little bit why I thought that maybe Scala would be a nice fit. I don't want to talk about that now. Also, perhaps my priorities have shifted quite a bit, but I'm still happy that I stuck to Scala. So for those who have been to previous Scala Days conferences, I was here a couple of years ago and presented this kind of translation from SuperCollider to Scala called Scala Collider. That was in 2012. These plots, they show a bit of the Git activity on different libraries or modules that make up this system that I present today, Mellite. And Scala Collider is one of them. So it's an early one. Later came Sound Processes, which is a kind of a framework to model higher abstractions for sound. Fscape then was revived actually not so long ago, so it's now based. There's two versions now: the old Java one and a completely rewritten one in Scala, which came across as a side effect, but it was stipulated also by a research project on sonification, in which this non-real-time rendering was very handy to prepare data sets, because it can run faster than real-time, actually. Another system is Patterns, which is also familiar for those who know SuperCollider. It's also a translation, and that was an experiment within the Almat project. And then finally, Mellite is here at the bottom. The story actually goes a bit back, so the activity actually started with something else. So this whole endeavor is somehow kind of an outcome or effect of my PhD research, which ran roughly from 2009 to 2014, with a system that I call Lucre. I will explain that in a bit. It's about the question of tracing compositional activity. So we all know that from software development, we cannot imagine a world anymore that is not with everything checked into a repository and versioned and so on. And I was kind of exploring that idea for music composition. So back to Mellite, where the name Mellite is, it literally translates to honeystone, perhaps because in some configurations it's a mineral, and in some kind of configurations or consistencies it can kind of have the color of honey. And why I chose that name, I don't know, because you have to find a name that is kind of convenient to, because you're going to talk about it a lot for many years. And I thought that this idea of minerals, that they have this optical property that they refract stuff in different layers and different perspectives, is kind of a nice metaphor or analogy to how I consider this system. So one of the things I wanted to do with Mellite is to integrate my different practices with sound into one application, different ways of different forms of art or sound art, but also in this context of the PhD research to integrate this observation of time in different ways of the compositional process. So the three forms that for me are the archetypical forms that I would like to be able to represent within this one framework are sound installation, live improvisation with computers, and what you would probably call electroacoustic music or tape music. And I will just, so that you get a very broad idea, give three very quick examples of that. So this is a kind of a shot from a sound installation called Configuration from 2015. So this all the examples are kind of made with maybe not just Mellite, but also with the different frameworks that it links to. And in a sound installation, it's for me, it's a spatial medium. So it's about a space, often a site-specific work that incorporates elements of the space. In this case, it's the basement of a ship, and you can see here a metal a window kind of in the wall has a metal object. So the metal objects are here like used as loudspeakers. And the idea of the installation is that it's not a pre-rendered sound, but it's a computation that's ongoing. So I have to kind of be able to formalize algorithms that analyze and produce sounds. So that's one, in a way, of the use cases for this framework that is Mellite. The second one is live improvisation. This perhaps you have also seen if you have been there in 2012 days. It's an interface that sits on top of sound processes which allow me to use predefined musical blocks that I program and connect them. It's very much like a modular sound synthesis system. And so this is, at the time, it looked similar, but the whole architecture below has changed in the meantime. And now it's also integrated. So you can, for example, you can create these blocks, you can configure them, and you can also interlink them with one another, what's happening here now. And then the third kind of, if you categorize the media, would be tape composition. This is a screenshot and sound example from a piece from 2012, Leere Null or Empties, in which my idea was to start with a concrete sound. You can see here sonograms, so the spectrum over time display of sounds, and go from a very small sound cell, an existing sound, and cut it and take it apart. So create a spacing, create an empty space in between, and let the computer run over a database of sounds to find a suitable sound in terms of acoustic similarity, for example. So in the second part of that piece, I'm using also an interactive and non-interactive process to generate these structures. So when you think of, if you are familiar with digital audio workstations, they have these kind of timelines in which you play sound files, but they have no capabilities to algorithmically generate these structures, at least not without a lot of complications. So that's another scenario I want to address. So here are again the three layers, or simplified three layers of the system. I want to briefly talk about them before I then go in the middle part of the presentation to demo a little bit the system. This is Lucrezia, so that's why the system's called Lucre. She was born at the time when I created the system. So Lucre is this base layer. It has basically three functions, if you want. So one is called system facade, which means since I want to trace different temporalities of working with sound, or the creation of sound, it can abstract over them. So there's objects that are parameterized with a system type. The system can be in memory, ephemeral, so you create an object, you manipulate it, when your process quits, the object is gone. Or it can be made durable, so the system can automatically persist objects, so it has a kind of a serialization layer built in. The whole architecture is based on the software transactional memory paradigm, whereas in this case, of course, because we want also to persist it, so we want to have full asset properties, this coupled to the transactions of a key value store. The last one I will not talk about, this was basically my research, the confluent one is then on top of the durable layer, you also keep track of all the history of the modifications of objects. So you can basically go at any point back in history of a piece, let's say. The second thing is this object model. So what is that? It's kind of saying we need a simple abstraction that can represent all these kind of persistable objects in the system. And one particularity is that the objects have an attribute map associated with them, which is, for me, played out very nicely as a very simple formalism to be able to interconnect objects and to be able to add functionality and do things that is more common, maybe of dynamic languages. Lucre then also kind of adds a number of useful objects. So for example, some of the primitive types, they are wrapped. So if you think of a Scala int, integer number, then you have a corresponding object called int object. So the type parameter S here is the system. So it's an int object that is either just in memory or an int object that lives in a workspace that is persisted to hard drive. And these are kind of expressions. If you think of a reactive system, the int object can be mutable, and it can then publish events when it updates its value. Also, collection objects like lists and dictionaries from time points to objects. Sound processes then, obviously the name says it, it adds the notion of sound and also of time. I departed from this idea of duplicating the model view controller metaphor, but usually we think of the view as something visual. And so in this case, it's aural view. I call them aural views. I don't know if that's like a strange term, but it means that the model, let's say a sound description, it's a persistent object. It lives in your workspace. You can close it. You can come back. There is your model. But to actually produce sound, you need to go to a view of that model, which also means that you can have multiple sounding objects from the same model, which is kind of a really nice property. And of course, also, we need to bridge between this atomic isolation and so on properties of a transaction and the side effects of outputting sound. This is talking to Scala Collider, basically. The temporal dimension is very simple in this system. It's a really, really basic idea. It's like the divine one sample rate that is valid throughout any project, no matter at which sample rate your sound card runs or your sound files are. This strange number is simply the less common multiplier of common audio sample rates. So there's no notion of some musical higher abstraction times such as beats and bars and so on. It was never so relevant to me. It could be added at some point. Also, of course, you can then do scheduling in real time. And transport means to turn models into aural objects at specific points in time. Sound process then also adds abstractions. So objects that are relevant to sound, PROC is the most relevant one. It encapsulates one kind of program that produces sound, a sound producing function. It also has a folder that is like a list of objects, and it has a timeline which maps time intervals to objects, and a grapheme that is more like a breakpoint function, maps points in time to objects, and many others. And then this picture is also a bit of a simplification. So there are actually more modules linked into Mellite. I already mentioned some. So these are partly taking advantage of sound processes. Some of them are just based on the object model of Lucre, which means that Mellite basically is a layer on top that integrates all these things together in one sort of standalone application. It allows you to create and open so-called workspaces. Workspaces are basically databases of all the objects. And if you are familiar with a system such as MaxMSP or Pure Data, you have this notion of a document or a patcher. That's basically the workspace. It's both a document for your creation, where you create a piece, and it's also a document that plays back your piece. So it's both a composition environment and a performance environment, if you like. Perhaps also a curious choice is that we combine graphical editors with text editors, so I'm using embedded Scala editing in the application that I will show. Now it's based on the new version is using an editor that I started to write in January called Dotavide. I will say a few words about that. So now it's time maybe to demo. So Mellite is opening up, and I can theoretically create a new workspace. Here are these three system types: in-memory, durable, and confluent. But for the sake of the demonstration, I will just use something I have prepared in advance. And I will open a little memo so I don't get lost. This is kind of my replacement for not having slides now. So it has a little markdown editor integrated, which I find nice for keeping notes. That's something that interests me a little bit. How do you compose? What does it mean? What are all the activities you do? You're not just like editing sound. You're also thinking about stuff, memorizing stuff. And that's kind of my interest in this project, to understand everything that belongs into this process. How can that be integrated? So I said already proc is kind of the basic primitive to write sound code. Is the text size okay for you to read, or should I make it? Yeah? Okay. Because I have this new feature that I can make it bigger, so. So, but some of the stuff cannot get, it's a swing, the UI is swing, so it's not super duper fancy in terms of what we know today in browsers, but it's working. So this is an example not actually written by me, just translated. It's from James McCartney, the original author of Super Collider. Probably I've shown it in the previous example presentation as well, so I don't want to spend that much time in it, just for you to have a coarse idea. So here we are basically in an editor that is running inside the process of Mellite. So that's a bit perhaps similar to, I was thinking a lot about it when I saw the Jupyter presentation. I think there's a lot of similarities with these interactive environments. Basically, we're running code, and the code can interact with objects of the environment itself, which is not the normal view of an IDE, in which the process of the IDE is completely isolated from your project. Your Scala project is not about manipulating IntelliJ or Eclipse, but in this case it is. One thing that is becoming problematic is, of course, in real time you want to be able to respond very fast. Scala is not extremely fast in compilation. Okay, so you know it took maybe a second to compile. So if I place those sounds on a timeline, I don't want to know that I need to do it a second in advance and have a dedicated thread for the compiler. So how do I solve this? These programs, they get compiled, and then they get executed, actually. So that means when I say apply, what it's doing, it's creating instance of the Scala compiler and compiles the program. It executes the program. The program yields a syntax tree of this particular domain-specific dialect, which is for the real-time sound processes. So basically, I get a tree. The tree, the leaf of the tree is this out object, and then in this out object, there's a constant, and then there is this bit is the next one up in the level. So it's basically a very easy way to serialize the stuff in the end also, and it's fast to serialize. And more importantly also, we don't need to worry when I'm changing to, so this is Scala 2.12 still. I can see it here. It already runs in 2.13, yeah, but I haven't tested it much. But the problem will be if I compile this to Scala bytecode, then we are lost. It will be broken in the next version. So instead, I'm serializing the trees. So how does this sound? Let's see if it works with the sound card. So that's the famous analog bubbles example. It's just a sine oscillator that is whose frequency is modulated, and there's an echo added, which is this comp filter effect. Out means it sent the signal to a bus, and zero is my sound card bus. So this editor is has been exchanged recently. So you have, of course, the syntax highlight, which is really nice. You also have some forms of, I don't know if it's visible. Yeah, you can look up. Basically, you can go to definition. Of course, for five liner, it doesn't make much sense. It's using the presentation compiler currently. And the editor component itself, I'm very grateful to Pavel Fatino sitting in front of me here. He has written this project called Toy IDE. And basically, this is derived from the Toy IDE, which is has a kind of a similar feel of IntelliJ. Many of the default keyboard shortcuts are the same. Of course, it's much reduced. But yeah, we can do stuff. We can even, you know, we can find autocomplete stuff. The autocompletion is a bit, naya, not so nice. The next version will be nicer, but at least you can find the symbols, and you can also look up the integrated API documentation. Also, that's the current solution. Use a Scala doc. I will hopefully can use a better, malleable representation of other version in the future. Okay, so then I wanted to show you quickly how to create a new process. So the example was this one. LFSAW is short for low frequency SAW oscillator. So SAW oscillator goes like this, a bit like your old TV screens. The signal for the horizontal thing, it goes always from left to right and it jumps back to left, and that's a periodic signal. Sounds like a pitch with a couple of overtones. So how do I create a new object? Either I go through the GUI, or I also have now this kind of keyboard shortcuts. I can say proc, hello Scala world, Scala days, hello world. Was that mixed up with Scala days? So here's my new proc. It's empty, and I just paste the example from the API, and I should be able to do that. This kind of techno-ish sound. Only on the left channel, because it's mono. Super Collider has this nice property of being able to expand arrays, or collections of so vectors, basically. So now I have two, and they will go run out of each other. Okay, that's fine, but that's a bit limited. Now how can I, I cannot create a piece that, I can maybe create a piece, but I would like to interact with environment. So let me introduce maybe the environment. Let's say I want to control this basic parameter here, and then I can patch that here, something like that. It has a default, so it should still sound the same. And then I can show you here the so-called attribute map. So each object has this kind of key value map, which is kind of a strange thing, but when you get used to it, it's kind of very intuitive. So I can actually create a key here, and then let's say I make it a bit slower, or I edit it here. I don't know what happens if I do it very fast. Okay. So that gives you a very coarse idea of this. There's also patterns. I'll show them very briefly. So basically, we have different DSLs in here. One is this real-time DSL for sound synthesis processes. The patterns, they're basically just generators of sequences. So a Brownian motion starts as a random number and then goes in steps up and down in this range that I specify here. So if I evaluate that here, then I can see it picked 62 as the first one and then goes down, down, up, 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 down. So it's just in Max it's called drunk. It's like somebody walking drunk. You go a little bit, you correct, you go, and you stay within those bounds. How do you make a sound of that? Well, you simply say that's a parameter for a sound. Let's say the pitch. I'm not going to show that here. So that's a bit more complex. The nice thing of this is I can still use functions, local functions, because we're still evaluating a tree. We're still, in the end, serializing the pattern tree. But I can use auxiliary functions. They will just be executed once, so still not a problem for the persistence of that. So this bind pattern is a special pattern that simply takes kind of a map from parameters to stuff, and it has conventional keys. The convention for play is like look up a process that you can play, and all the other parameters will be passed into that process. So that's also a very boring example. This is the drunk walk, basically with the sine tone, blink, blong, blong. And then I can go from there to more complex structures. For example, I can create parallel patterns, so they will be interleaved in time. It's just two pitches now. You can see they're walking in random ranges in two different registers and also at different paces. Okay? That one was, so that's already giving us another abstraction. And then maybe the timeline as an example. Well, I don't have it here. I think I put it down here. I wanted to create it from scratch. I think it's taking a bit too much time, so I'm going to just show it. So the timeline object allows us then to place those objects in a linear timeline, let's say. So I can basically say sequence those two things. And I can, of course, add other objects. Sorry for the cacophonic example. I was not very inspired when I was doing that. But you can also use a very simple... you can also use the... We can use this one. We can just... It has this method of drag and drop, so I can actually just add that one here. So there's this example of the saw oscillator. I can also use sound files. The sound files will show here nicely with sonograms. Why it doesn't play? Well, because it uses it doesn't want to prescribe the bus to which it's playing. So if I go into the source code, it's just this is also kind of Scala Collider, Super Collider code. It's just taking a sound file, playing that back to an internal bus. This is the code for internal bus. So I can quickly wire that up here. I take a mono to stereo signal, and then I can connect them and.
Essayez de lire, de me lire, comme un autre.
Okay, so I have a lot of different abstractions here. I don't know how am I on time. I don't think I'm okay. Fscape I haven't showed yet, but maybe that's the last thing to show as a demo. So we have enough time also for questions. Fscape, so looks this is kind of a third language now, but very similar to the real-time language. It's just if you look carefully at it, so you can use unary binary operators to work with signals. I think it's a very interesting. It can become a very interesting signal processing language. There's of course specialized signal processing languages that have good adaption. Let's say Faust, for example. But it's not so trivial to write a nice signal processing language. And here I try to copy this Eugen model from SuperCollider to non-real time. It's implemented using Akka streams. So all these Eugens, they're basically forming a tree of nodes in an Akka stream system. I think I have somewhere here. This is my ugly example of using actions. Actions are basically your way you can inject any Scala code. So this one will break if the binary compatibility breaks. It will just execute the code as a program. It will compile to a function and execute the function. This is just for me to be able to open this shell program here. So this is basically the problem you have currently, I have currently a lot in Fscape. You run a lot into deadlocks in Akka stream if you are using buffering. I'm using buffering because I don't want to process sample by sample, so they're in blocks. And when you have, and then you have in signal processing often diamond structures. And every diamond structure is a potential problem for creating these kind of deadlocks, where one is waiting for a signal and two others cannot produce because they are blocked. So that's something that's a research topic to automatically insert buffering nodes in the system. So this is an example. It's already quite lengthy. So just for you to see, FFT is a typical signal process to take the spectrum. It's doing a convolution with a noise. So what it's doing? It's taking a sound file. It's this one that we already heard.
Je vais donc essayer de lire, de me lire comme un autre.
And then it applies this convolution with the noise, which just makes it blurry in time. So it's a rendering. I call it rendering. It goes fast or slow depending on the process. And I already imported the output here, but usually you would have to do that separately. And you can still hear the resonances of the voice. But of course, they're now the impulse response is 5 seconds, so it's a very long delay, a very long reverberation. And I think with that, I will quit the demo. Unless I missed something. Maybe just as a side note, Fscape can also be used for image processing. So this zooming out of the example in the beginning, I actually did it with Fscape just for the sake of, you can do it with any video program, but since I have it to my avail, I did it with Fscape. So you can, I do also video and image processing with Fscape. That's perhaps enough for the demo. So let's go back here. I think I'm almost done. I don't have much slides left. this is a, maybe a kind of a recap of how, if you've, you know, you step back from all of this and you rethink of what is happening here, or what is the system actually that we have created. This grayish part, for me, that's kind of the layer that I have presented. So I call it an IDE. It's a mouthful. It's, of course, not a fully fledged IDE like we know from programming languages, but it does use this idea of integrating different components together in the development and execution of sound objects. And I hope and I think it can be used also with different profiles of users or artists. You could, in a way, like you can give a PD or Max patch to somebody, they don't necessarily need to know PD or Max. If it's a program that they can execute and configure, that will be here on the left side. So you can create a piece and give it to somebody, whether that's an artist or not, and or a scientist. That was the case with the sonification. We gave it to climatologists, and they had to configure the sonification using user interface components. Of course, they didn't program the sounds, but these two things can live in the same application. The advanced user then, of course, will take advantage of this ability to program different components of the system using Scala, which I find very nice. So I just hope that the editor will be a bit more comfortable in the future. And of course, the application itself, it's still developed in a regular IDE. It's developed I use IntelliJ at the moment. So I create also, when I create sound pieces, I often write directly with the API of sound processes in an IntelliJ project. So I write, I run, I stop, I write, I run. And so I'm trying in a way to move I don't know why the arrow is pointing this way. I'm trying to move in the opposite direction and try to see if this system can be made powerful enough or comfortable enough that I can develop pieces more and more in the system and not having to go back to a full IDE. So what's up for the future of this? This is a bit of a grab bag, let's say. I didn't really prioritize. This is just like all the things that come to my mind that I find would be interesting as future developments. One of them is I really would like in the next year or so, while I still run the current research project, do a sound installation that runs in the browser using sound processes, not Mellite, the IDE you don't need. But the good thing is the workspaces, you can run them in sound processes as long as you don't need UI. You just want to run the processes, you don't need the UI. And so compiled already a bit of Fscape. So somebody, I don't know who's the author, but so there's an effort to make a Scala JS version of AkkaStream. So that was running. I would have to figure out how to work with sound files and sound output, but the general thing, it would run in the browser. And I'm also hoping for maybe a very reduced sound synthesis server, much more reduced than SuperCollider, maybe smaller, but in the same philosophy, using maybe Scala native with WebAssembly. Let's see if that happens. Then more on Mellite itself, on the IDE. Networking became very important for me, so I do a lot of sound installation that run on little Raspberry Pis because they're affordable and you usually need a lot of them, so they need to be networked. That's a formalism that should be baked into the idea of the workspace. How can you distribute a workspace? And also perhaps think about, we already have transactions and we know all from normal versioning systems, you have the users there, different people can contribute. So how can we maybe add this kind of collaborative aspect to the system? So Dot Divider, it's currently using the Scala presentation compiler. I just hacked it in a few days, let's say, so it's very simple. The hope is that somebody may be super inspired and wants to write a metals, an LSP client, and we can use metals in the future. Maybe I do it myself if I find time, I don't know. But that, I think, would be super duper great to have a language server client. Then as a research project, I think the transition to Dotty will be super exciting. So it's a completely has new metaphors, new abstractions. So how can this big system be changed, actually? What do we have to change? And then what Rory Graves was talking about, this idea of the inverse index is very important. You can get lost in this windowing system. You don't know where an object is used. So being able to build, like in an IDE, say, find usages, something like that we will need. And also writing code, it's kind of annoying that you cannot just write dot map, dot flat map. You can, in some cases, with patterns, you can, because you have a container. But it would be nice maybe to look at if we cannot maybe persist some stuff of direct Scala code, if it's kind of compatible. Maybe we can use something that goes in that direction. And last not least, I'm hoping that more people use this system. It's of course a very idiosyncratic system, and obviously has a lot of bugs. I'm basically the only developer, but I'm very happy to help people to get started, and also contributors are very welcome. Whatever your interest is, I think this system can be used in many different ways. So there's the website for Mellite. It's a fully open source system, and it has instructions how to install it and so on. You can also compile it from source. This is the research project. This is my email address. I'm not using this Google, Facebook, whatever, but if you go to my webpage and you are by chance using Mastodon or Diaspora, you can also find my contacts there. Mm-hmm. So I think now we have a few minutes left for questions. Thank
you. First of all, wow. What can you do with this software? What you can do with MaxMSP, for example, and why did you choose Scala?
Okay, at the time, so when I started, obviously you can see the trajectory is coming from SuperCollider. I always prefer to write text than to interlink objects. I use also PD, which is an open source version and a open source variant of Max. It's very useful for workshops because people, that's why I kind of envy, is people can get started with PD in half an hour, basically. It's a really nice system to teach and use for workshops, but it also, it's a bit like you have these different kind of slopes. You can get started very fast, but then when you make some trivial stuff, it's incredibly complicated. You know, mapping over a collection, that's something we can do in a piece of code, but that's impossible almost to do. It's not impossible, but you almost shoot yourself if you want to do that, or multi-channel sound. It's not maybe it's coming, I don't know what they're working on, but multi-channel sound has been always a problem, I think, for these visual systems. And perhaps, I don't know if I quit already, but so the new system also has kind of a fifth or fourth language for creating widgets. So I never liked the idea of PD and Max that you have the sound-producing logic along with the interacting logic. It makes sense for some simple things, but otherwise it gets really in your way. I don't think it's a good decision. I think it's much better to have different perspectives on what you're doing. One of them can be a user interface, and the other one can be the sound logic. And in a way, I'm trying in a way to understand what is it that makes PD and Max so attractive, and many people use it because the usability is very good. It's just, I don't think they scale very, very well, but this kind of accessibility is something I would like to integrate, but it's, of course, these are like applications that exist for a very long time, there's a company behind. But it's possible, I think we can go in that direction. So why I choose Scala, and well, I already mentioned one point in the beginning, my previous background was in Java, so for me, I wanted something that I had a soft start with at the time, so I wanted to be able to use the libraries that I had already written and, you know, move them slowly. And then I was interested in being able to write a music language for a language for computer music without writing boilerplate. So Java is not an option for that. You want something that looks like Ruby or like Python or like a dynamic language. And Scala is a fantastic language for creating these kind of domain-specific languages without obfuscating the stuff. You can still make it very clean without too crazy constructions, but you take away the need from the user to write stuff that they don't really need to know or write about. So I think Scala is really in a sweet spot there. And of course, when I started, it was 2.7. So it was nowhere near where we are now. For example, my example is like named and default arguments. Being able to do that, it's such a great thing, and it it has always improved in that direction. So I think it's a good language to do that, even if many people would say it's maybe not the beginner's language, but I think it's a really, really nice language to integrate. So there's some systems, you know, let's say Godot engine, open source game engine. It's written in C++, and then you have to learn a scripting language that is not exactly Python, but similar to Python to do the things. Why don't we stay in the same code? Why don't we stay in the same language?
Hey, so great talk. I'm really interested in the role of this offline rendering process, mm-hmm. And sort of what you do with Fscape and all these non-real-time techniques that you can't do with a real-time DSP language like mm-hmm. SuperCollider.
So I'm very good in making the stuff so that it's slower than real-time. I mean, when you start to experiment, and also, of course, the system, I don't think it's nowhere near Faust or these kind of languages which are written by engineers who are into signal processing and they try to make the maximum out of it. So it's probably not the fastest way to do it. But for me, it's more important that it's a possibility to experiment with. And for me, always the non-real-time stuff was interesting because, I don't know if I have this slide. I have some extra slides somewhere. Well, if I find it, that is. Let me see. If not, not. If only I remember how I called that. I think it's this. Can we make that bigger? No. Yeah. So in a way, for me, it's interesting when I look at compositional process. Then people get easily excited about real time. This engagement that you are kind of synchronous with the system. You do something, it reacts. You do something, it reacts. But, I mean, traditional instrumental composition is completely different. You sit somewhere with your pencil and you pencil something. And then you get to convince an ensemble that they will perform your piece. And then you go to the performance. And then you're frustrated because they don't do it like you expected. And then you go and rewrite it, maybe. That's maybe the other extreme. But I think this kind of distance between... I like the idea of computation as something that has its inherent speed that is not tied to the acoustic reproduction of a signal. So for me, it's kind of poetic to say that I'm going to put the computer to, you know, render this stuff, and tomorrow morning I have all the sound files, and then I pick some. I mean, the video is even more extreme. So video processing, I'm really happy I'm not a video artist, because that's so incredibly, you need to be super duper patient. Sound, at least, the bandwidth is, the amount of numbers is not so high, so you can actually do a lot of funny stuff with. And I'm interested in resorting things and producing large batches of sounds and then maybe filtering them again. So, and all that requires a kind of a detachment. So you have like a, this is maybe a nice way to describe it. When we think about random access, so in the history of computer music, of course, was the introduction of tape, like it was in film as well. And I may just quote, I don't know if I'm running over time, but it's okay. So I'm just going to read it out. So it's, in the days of manual editing, tape-based editing was essentially random access, since new material could be inserted at any position in the tape. In film and sound effects editing, this is still the case. The trim bin becomes the random access storage and retrieval device. Every different sound or picture has a different hook in the trim bin or around the room. And the editor can swiftly retrieve any piece of sound and splice it into place. So I think that's really a nice observation about how we compose things. It's not so much that we can edit something in any place, but that we have a space in a way where all the stuff is found. So my memory is limited, my attention is limited, I have other activities, I go away, I come back, and I want to be able to find this stuff somewhere in a space. So for me, that's also what I call workspace. I think it's a very useful metaphor to think of this idea of artifacts that have physical presence. They're files, and they will be there, and they occupy my hard drive, and it's full, and so on. But they have this kind of existence as stuff. And that's kind of enabled for me by the non-real-time system, because it needs a container to store the stuff, so that's files. question.
Thank you very much for the talk. It was very very useful and very impressive and very entertaining. I was a bit curious about the part you mentioned about writing a smaller language for writing the compositions and mm-hmm. so on. So I saw that you have written like something which is like Scala syntax. That's what you were showing, right?
Yeah, it is Scala. It's a standard Scala compiler. It's what you would call an embedded domain-specific language. I don't know if it's a language. It's just like abstractions that make it natural to express specific things, although it's standard Scala.
Yes, it can be called the domain-specific language, fair enough. I was curious if you are familiar, and if so you were considering taking on the direction of a DSL called Euterpia?
Utopia?
Are you familiar with it?
Or? No, I mean, it doesn't ring a bell with me, no. Maybe afterwards I can write it down. And
look certainly.
Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. For the real-time stuff that you were doing, did you encounter any issues with the garbage collection? And maybe at times in the JVM may decide to pause the garbage collection?
We always talk about bit rot and this kind of stuff. But actually, it's super duper great that we are now 10 years later. So the same stuff is actually now very smooth, even if it's the same code like 10 years ago. So initially, it was actually much more a problem because computers were much slower. I'm having here in the application, but that's actually also SuperGlide itself is doing the same thing because we need to talk to a server. So there's a need in a way to for precise timing. So we need to account for a latency. I'm using a very, very conservative latency here. So it means when a transaction can take very long. It's atomic in the logical sense, but it can take a long time, especially if the JVM is not warm or you're using objects that haven't been used yet. And so in practice, I find these 200 milliseconds, for example, is totally acceptable. I rarely run, the SuperCollider will tell you, so the communication, the real-time system is, there's a protocol called Open Sound Control. So it's basically like a socket between the client and the server. We're sending commands to the server, let's say, instantiate that sound or change the parameter of that sound. And these can be time-tagged called in a so-called OC bundle. When the bundle arrives too late, you will see in the post window, in the lock window, late. That means, okay, we didn't make it. We missed the real-time deadline. But, I'm also running a rather recent computer, so it depends really on what you want to do and how important it is. In often cases, if latency is not important, then you can just increase the latency and you get perfect timing. If you do live electronics with an instrumentalist, you don't want a second to pass between what instrumentalist is playing and the output. You can set that to zero and it will use a special time tag now and it will just allow jitter, but it does it as fast as possible. But let's say I do a sound installation, it runs on a Raspberry Pi. The Raspberry Pi is really struck. I mean, the Mellite, I can run it on the Raspberry Pi, but the memory is more a problem. So JVM application, the memory usage is quite high. Performance is more also on the server, is split between client and server. Since they are separated, it's okay if the client is sometimes slower, as long as we don't get audio dropouts. You can run it on the Raspberry Pi, but of course you have to reduce your kind of expectation of how much stuff you can do. So I don't, to be honest, in the beginning I thought, when I chose the system, I thought, is that really a good idea to use the JVM with this garbage collection and so on? Well, I have never seen that kick in. This stop the world thing, I haven't seen it actually in years, so I don't know. Maybe I'm just lucky or it doesn't apply in this kind of configuration. Well, thank you very much.